Nadine, Marchena, Kean is one of the most, how to describe her? I've never been to a meeting where she has called and sat down. I've never seen a more prepared person than she. She's always covered every base, every angle. Any question you ask, this woman can answer it in a snap. It's never been a problem. So I'm sure that this little thing today is going to just show us how great she is. Very happy about that.
Yeah.
And thank you all for coming. And Nadine, knock yourself out, please.
Good day. Good afternoon. My chat today is entitled, it's going to be a discussion, an exercise. This is preservation, revitalization, and me. We've had the two Davids, and I missed the second David, but they both talked about preservation in a different way. And I thought we're going to turn it around a little bit, because I'm not naming it David, I'm naming Nadine. And we're going to talk about preservation, revitalization, and me. And it's going to be an exercise, so I want everyone to get it along. We only have a few of us, but we're going to do it. Yes?
Yes. Yes.
All right.
So, whenever we come into this discussion and we get into an uncomfortable place, it's because we have not really looked at who's in the room and where we stand. So I'm going to introduce myself in a different type of way today. He gave me a lot of pressure, but I'm going to ignore that. I am a traveler. I'm a person that likes to travel the world. And I travel the world looking at culture. I want to experience all there is to experience wherever I go. So I eat the food, I try to understand the language, I visit their cultural meccas, the areas where they're doing things that make sense for the people that live there. So the tourist traps, the tours where someone in a taxi is giving you is not what I usually do. I try to find somebody that lives there and we walk and talk and understand the place. I'm American. That is a contentious situation right now. When we look at the decisions of the courts with regard to the territories, and it's something that we should all be aware of and look at. I'm a daughter of the Caribbean. I've studied my ancestry going back to the 1600s, and I can go from Curacao to Bonaire to Trinidad to Grenada, St. Eustatia. I can go to Virgin Mora, Tortola, Navegada. I can go to Puerto Rico, to Cuba, and the Dominican Republic. I have family in all of those places, and my family comes from all of those places. But as they would say, my navel string is buried here because I am a native Virgin Islander. So understand that I am all of these things. And also, and my perspective comes from the understanding that I study history. Anyone's history that affects the Virgin Islands. So as the French was involved, as the Brits were involved, and so forth. I've studied them all as it pertains specifically to their influence, their travels in and out of this particular territory, whether it was the Danish West Indies or now the U.S. Virgin Islands. And I studied my family history and other people's family history too. I'm an economic developer. I specialize in business development and community development. And I've done that in places like Japan. I've traded, imported, exported, made deals all over the world. I'm a certified public manager, and I started my career in private sector. but now I've achieved working in government longer than I've worked in the private sector. So know that I'm coming from that place. We're going to talk about that a little bit more. I'm a daughter. I'm proud. I'm a wife. I'm a mommy. And I do this, and I've talked about my prejudices, my perspectives, but my motives, or my motivation, anything I'm doing, I'm thinking of my two children, Tiana, who's sitting here with us today, and Diego, my son. So anything I do, any business I help, I think to myself, okay, this is how we're going to move forward because I want my children to inherit a piece of this beautiful island called St. Thomas. And so as we step forward to fix a building or to explain a section of history or to help a business grow here in the territory, it's all because I want my children to inherit a very small piece of this territory in a successful way. So that's who I am. I want you all to think about, we're not going to talk about everything today, but I want you to think about the perspective of what you bring, your prejudices, your motives, your motivation, right? As we talk about the Virgin Islands and how we're going to move forward in a positive way. Okay. So. Preservation, revitalization. We've talked about it. Everyone understands that preservation is carefully maintaining or bringing something back to where it should be. Revitalization is the act or activity of giving new life to something. They may not be the same thing, but for me, they're intertwined. So, brought along some books with me today. Some of my favorites. The Virgin Islands and Their People by J. Antonio Jarvis. The Virgin Islands Picture Book by Antonio Jarvis and Rufus Martin. And The Virgin Islands of the United States by Luther Zabriskie. I'm a collector of Virgin Islands history books. If you have some that you just don't want anymore, I'll take it. These can sit on a shelf. They give information about the Virgin Islands. They can sit on the shelf. But, and that's the preservation side. You know, we have the information, it's there. We try to keep it as pristine as possible. These are sometimes secondhand books, so, you know, we try to keep them as pristine as possible. But, as I'm an economic developer, revitalization is critical. So, for me, I have to use the book. I have to read them. I need to be able to go through them. They cannot sit on the shelf and be left alone. Right? Same thing with our buildings. So our buildings, we can fix them and then preserve them in exactly the way they were 150 years ago. Or we can fix them in the way that they were, but add things inside that can now have an internet trading company or anything technological, things that my daughter and my son would be interested in doing in the future, so the building stays alive. We don't want, and if you look carefully, this is a nicely restored waterfront area. If you look carefully, we don't want that Potemkin-type village where, see this? This is just a wall. There's nothing behind of that. There's no building, there's no usage to that. It looks pretty. The front looks pretty, nicely decorated and painted and built, but this is just a wall. It's not a real building. And we need to think about, when we step forward to talk about preservation and revitalization, that we are talking about something real, that we think about what we're going to use the building for and move forward in that particular light. So what are our challenges? big one, lack of funds, lack of motivation, lack of the recognition of the gem we have in the territory, our historic towns. Poor planning. We don't have a land and water use plan. We don't have it. It's not there. We haven't done it. Changing demographics. The people that own these buildings don't live in the buildings anymore. And so when you live in a building, you care more about your building than if you have rented it and moved off island and not here. Deteriorating infrastructure. Our roads, our pipe and our piping system, the electricity and how we're dealing with that. I mean, these are things that we need to really think about. A big one. Our lack of action. Our lack of action. It is one that's the most debilitating. It is one that we're gonna do this and then nothing. So those are our challenges. So we're gonna do an exercise. It's anonymous. You don't have to put your name. It doesn't matter.
What's the price? small one, please.
You get your choice of page.
Another one, okay.
Yeah, okay. I'll be ready to check.
Nadine, I've got extra ones here.
Just do your best with it.
Okay, you need an extra pen, don't we?
That's the one she's answered, right? That was question four.
Here's a small one. Everybody's had it in? Tiana? I'm gonna shake it.
No.
Okay. Now we have question two. Okay, now while I look at these, on your small card, you're going to write down what one small activity can you do to promote preservation and or revitalization?
That's a good question.
One small activity can you do? Because the me in my chat is not about Nadine Marchena again. It's about each one of us. I'm sure you guys have thought about this before. Is that me? Balance? You know, because this is the whole rest of my chat, so this would be a problem. Anybody else? Anybody else? Everybody's handing in? Okay. Big ideas. One big idea. When we look at the big ideas, we have quite a few people that said the government should be the one that implements the idea. And we talked about the challenges before, remember? The challenges were lack of funds, deteriorating infrastructure and things like that. Government faces the same issues that we as individuals face. And part of why I decided that this would be my topic today was because there was an email that was put up, a message that was put up on Facebook about 2 or 3 weeks ago. And we were talking, it was an internal conversation about doing some revitalization. And the person said, and they were saying that EDA would be doing these activities to further this positive movement that was going on. And the person responded, that's good. Perhaps it's because they feel guilty. And that is why they're taking action. And I am not necessarily a person that responds all the time. Ronnie says I have answers to everything. That doesn't mean that I usually say them. You know, if you ask me directly, I will respond. But I looked out of my office, and there were my team members. They were all hovered over a desk working on a particular problem. And I thought to myself, well, I need to respond to this. And so response was that there is no guilt here. That government is really the people. And as you go in, you know, don't look at EBA or enterprise zone as an anonymous block of something. There are actually people behind those letters. And they are working ever so hard to try to help in this revitalization. But we face the same challenges. Every day I go in and we're looking for grants. Every day we deal with the same challenges of legislation, challenges of infrastructure, the delays of process. So we need to really think about that. We're not just sitting there going, is going to come up, but what are we going to get from it? That does not happen in our offices. It doesn't happen in historic preservation. It doesn't happen in DPNR where people think it happens. Sometimes we don't get lunch because we work through. Or sometimes we eat lunch at a desk. My co-worker is here looking at me, and that's because she knows. So it spurred my thoughts with regard to how do we look at revitalization in a different way and move it forward. Certainly we have the SHPO, we have HPC, we have Enterprise ECZ, or the Enterprise and Commercial Zone, ECZC. We have OTF in St. Croix, Outtown Fredericton. We have FEDA, we have St. Croix Foundation. We have the CCC, a new organization formed in St. Croix to assist Christians then be rejuvenated and revitalized and preserved. We have We From Upstreet, WeFus. We have the Long Path Garden Street Association. We have Kean, a new organization in Savan. We have the Downstreet People. We have lots of organizations that are there trying to work. And need I say, we have the Historic Trust. All people involved in trying to do the very same thing. We have DRI. All trying to preserve and revitalize at the same time. Trying to put ourselves out there. Most of the answers said government. So we're all facing the same issues. And the ideas are good, actually. Ideas I haven't really seen a lot of. A couple said education. It's a long-term type of discussion. The education means educating our young people, is what these were talking about, educating young people, so that we won't have that repeat of non-understanding of the gem that we have, which is awesome. Realize that we are, as we have always been historically, a town that's a melting pot of people. People that didn't go to school here. People that arrive. People that come with their own customs and cultures. We find a mattress in the gut. You ask, why are you doing that? And the answer might be, this is what we're doing. You wonder, why are you bringing this understanding of what you do at home to this territory? Well, they do it because they don't know anything else. When do you get to educate them? Sometimes they're not speaking in the language that you are speaking or I'm speaking. I'm going to tell you, my mother, my grandmother, my grandfather, my father, any one of them, if I was to drop a piece of paper on the ground, it would be a problem. They would expect that you did it accidentally and that you would pick it up immediately. It would be an embarrassment to the family that you were littering. Even a cover of a straw, this was not acceptable behavior. This is just how I was raised. And this is how my children are raised. They know They know that that is not acceptable behavior. But yet, there are people who throw the can into a drainage gut and think, oh, or drink on the ground and say, you know, somebody has a job because they will sweep that up.
Yeah.
I assure you that at Public Works, if there's no trash in the ground, there's more work to be done somewhere else. So education is great, but we have to think about education in the long range. Not only our young people, but we also have to think of other languages. We had 2 summer interns in this year in Enterprise Zone. One speaks Spanish and the other one speaks French. And we're using it as much as we can use it. They're bringing more, I think, than we're actually giving them. We're giving them a lot. We will learn Spanish and Patois by the end of the summer. And we're using it to also create signage and other things that can help different divisions within government to move forward. Not that other people can't do it. It's just that they're here and they're going to use their skills to the best of our ability. We'll be serving the entire historic, the enterprise zones. And a lot of the enterprise zones are made are people residing within those areas who are speaking Spanish. We had our first Spanish lesson the other day. My Japanese is better than my Spanish, and my Japanese is on the spot. We talked about supporting tax credits and supporting DRI and supporting organizations. Critical to our understanding. I named a bunch of organizations. How many of you have heard of CAN? Community Action Now.
Yes.
It's the newest of the organizations that have come to bear, and they're doing their work in Savan. So in July, Savan is going to look different. It's going to be a family fun day and all kinds of things happening. How many of us have heard of WeFus, We From Upstream?
Yeah.
Okay. So they are doing the same thing they're getting ready to do and work with the enterprise zone to vote on the plan for the future of Upstreet and the hospital ground area. The plans are awesome. And they come out next week at the end of the week for a vote. So the community will come together to vote on those plans.
Yeah.
There are organizations that are working on revitalization. I think what we need to do is form a council of all these organizations, right? We shouldn't be speaking here and there and there. We should try every now and then to speak with one voice and have one message. The majority said that we should bring life back to Main Street. A lot of you said that. And supporting DRI to do that. Move offices into deteriorating buildings via incentives. Okay, so I can't ask you the question because I don't know who wrote it, but I'm going to say this. Many of us here in the Virgin Islands, and many of us all over the place, fail to want to plan our estates. So, when we die, and we will die, we leave buildings there, and then, or you wrote something really quickly saying you're giving it to the government of the Virgin Islands, but in this beautiful building, I want a ballet school. The building must be painted pink like my mom liked it, and it must be a ballet school of the French order. There's a covenant put on the building. Remember I said the government of the Virgin Islands does not have any money or has a challenge of funds? That is an issue. Because what do we do with the building? We can't then put enterprise zone in the building. We can't put, because there's a covenant on the building. We own lots of buildings, but there is something that this person of their last breath has said, I want this building to be used for, here to the government. They didn't leave any money to the government to fix the building or to upkeep or to have, to pay this person to do a wonderful ballet school in the building. So what happens to the building? It dies. It becomes abandoned. Because we don't know how to deal with that covenant, that issue, that challenge. And then somebody steps forward and says, you know what? I want to pay for that ballet school. And then you lease it from the government. So it's a great idea. And we're working on those buildings that can be dealt with. But there are lots of buildings that just can't. So that's basically the big ideas. They're all great ideas. I think what we need to do is sort of, I think we need to form a council. I'm repeating this to the chairman and the executive director. I think we need to form a council of all of the different groups that are involved in revitalization, right? Because that way we can move forward with one message. We may have different ways of doing that message, but we can move forward with one message.
It's a matter of understanding what your group is doing. For instance, I serve on the Historic Preservation Commission, as well as being the president of this organization. But when the DRI started, they didn't invite us in to be part of their committee or their organization. And the day they finally, this is the Historic Preservation Commission, the day they finally invited us there to sit down, and they told us what they wanted to do, we were so happy to hear it and tell them, thank you very much. This is what we've been looking for all along. Oh, we thought you'd be in opposition. I said, what would you make you think that? Why didn't you come to us in the first place? If we were here from the beginning, it would be a whole different thing. You wasted a lot of time. So I mean, we've been trying to help them along with that, but it's the thought of not wanting to share with others what you want to do is where this group should be, as you say, and not be exclusive over we don't want to do that because they don't want to, and it doesn't work.
May I say something? I mean, do you want to continue without interruption?
No, I can do it.
Okay. Now, this brought to mind, to start something. Two things. I think you mentioned all these various organizations. They obviously take care of their boxes, so to speak. It's like too many cooks in the kitchen. But you keep going back to this very issue of the law on the books, which is a family of 100 family members, and if one does not go along with it, nothing happens. I think in order for us to do these buildings and do what we would like to do, and I think everyone will be happy if it's done, even though they may not admit it, because it's their building, that they will be given a certain amount of years, and if nothing happened, then government will have the authority to take charge.
I'm glad you said that.
Now, what comes to me now?
In the town of Christiansted. And in some parts of street, government owns in the street. The government owns quite a bit of the property. Okay. The last commissioner of property procurement, and not this one because they have not had the opportunity to speak with them yet, has indicated that they don't feel comfortable taking more property because they are struggling with the funds to upkeep the properties.
But then government put it up for sale.
Okay. So I told you that I am, and one of my prejudices is that I'm a genealogist, a historian. And where I present a challenge, I also present a solution. So, my four times great grandmother owned a building, and she has passed, she bought it, she was enslaved, and she bought it, and she passed it down to her family members. And it was, and it's been passed down from generation to generation to generation. This is all that she had from my studies of her. She came out of being enslaved, and she worked on purchasing this property. It was the only thing that she was successful, I shouldn't say that. It is what defines for me, because I did not, obviously did not meet her in person. It's what defines for me this individual that was Clara. Clara gave. She was able to move forward this understanding. Now, at this point, my father has passed. And his brother has passed. And his sister has passed. So now it belongs to several generations, several in our generation. And if we could not upkeep it or we did not know, I know because I'm a genealogist and a historian and I know my history. If I did not know of this property and the property was left there, I would want that opportunity to deal with it. For it to be sold is like selling my heritage and my understanding of myself. And I think that part of the challenges that we face now with the young people and the challenges that that present themselves in the area of crime is because they don't know themselves.
But that
they
building,
don't know.
This building has been maintained over the years. Is that really?
The building has been shuttered but maintained to that point. But it doesn't mean that I may not go there in Savannah right now and find that the building has been broken into for some reason and that someone is squatting in the building. That can happen from moment to moment. Okay? So, I think that those young people have sort of lost their connectivity with people. Sometimes these times when I read about them, I am a person that connects names to names. Okay? So although I carry the name Marchena, my cousin carries the name Hartman. Or Smith, or Turnbull, or Gabriel, they may not know that they're supposed to be related because they don't know their heritage. And in our built infrastructure, it's part of that heritage. I can go there and sit and read about things that happened 100 years ago.
But then you have the answer already, you have given the answer. If this is just your situation, that's probably 100 or 1,000 of other situations, and that's why nothing is being done.
Well, no, here is the solution. I said, challenge, I come with solutions. A la Ronnie's in charge. When presented with this idea, we've done surveys throughout the entire territory within the zones, all historic district areas. We have found that we have at least one building that has 54 owners. It's a small building. It's probably the size of this room, and that room put together. So, 54 owners. How do we do that? Our plan is once we get enough seed money, we're going to start fixing these buildings. The idea, and I encourage this organization to also look at joining us to do this, the idea is that we're going to fix the building. In the interim, while we're working on the building, you're going to, as a family, you don't have to talk to each other. You can sit right next to each other. You don't have to talk to each other, right? But you're going to form a corporation. And that corporation will work on maintaining, leasing, and running this building. As it's leased out, the monies should be used to fix and maintain that building. Any profits that come off of that, you will receive a check. We would have successfully dealt with the building. It will be an active building because it will be leased out. Right? Whether for residential or commercial use. The family never has to speak to each other again. They like it. If they don't want to, they don't have to. They can decide they don't want to be part of this. They can sell the shares to someone else or to back to the corporation that will then distribute the shares. What do you think of that solution?
How are you going to get these family members, if they cannot agree at this point for the corporation, how are you going to get them to agree to form a corporation?
They don't have to talk to each other, they have to sign something.
No. I don't care about this talk meeting. How are you going to get them to agree to it? They all have to say yes or no. How are you going to do that? Forget that they don't want to talk to each other. How?
Do they all have to form a corporation?
Yes.
It is an option that they can enter into. They can opt out. But many of the persons we have encountered when we started talking to family members, and we're in active discussion at this time, many of them may have a disagreement with their second cousin, but it's not that they don't want to deal with the building. Each one of them, individually, if they know about the building, want to deal with the building in some way, right? But they can't get along with that second cousin, that third cousin, that first cousin twice removed. You just can't.
That's a lot of persuasion on your part.
How do you find them?
So that comes to, this is wonderful.
Let me suggest something.
Hold on, how do you find them?
I mean, you're a genealogist, okay, you can find them, but how?
So my card, if I filled out my card would be that in order to move forward revitalization and preservation, I'm going to start working on some of these genealogies. I'm going to start. That is my individual, not my director enterprise zone position, but my individual call to action for myself to move forward this town for that person. Now there were lots of great ideas in mind as well. Right? Someone said that they're going to start visiting schools and start talking about our heritage. It's really critically important. And so we need to do that. Someone said clean property. I will step out and clean property with them. And I'll bring along my co-workers. I just need to convince them, I'll make some more. Some of you don't write, so I can eat.
Yeah, that's part of your right.
Someone said they're going to work towards lobbying and advocacy and legislation that will put teeth in preservation activities.
Really? That's a great idea.
Yes, I think so too. Someone said they're going to support the endeavors of others and other organizations. Several persons said that. This is a gem, and I have to thank this person for writing this one. Support locally owned businesses in our downtowns as much as possible. Mm-hmm. You know what that means? Mm-hmm. We need to work with, and they've heard me say this so I can repeat it. We need to work with bringing down the leases, the amounts, the costs to lease those buildings so that we can have people in those buildings. Let's make a little bit of money. And then you'll make lots more money later on. That's my opinion. I'm not representing the EDA this year.
I've heard they do that in St. Croix. They're very flexible.
They're doing it in St. Croix, and you're seeing people stay. Mm-hmm. And you're seeing stores open, but there's still stores closing, so there's things that we need to do. We have a program where we have 40 small businesses that manufacture products within the territory. I've just been told, and my co-worker called me on Friday afternoon, very excited. He found a store that's carrying 80 different vendors of locally manufactured products.
We.
In St. Croix?
In St. Croix and Frederickstown. We need to know about those products. Some of the products are awesome. I'm shopping there. I mean, beautiful, beautiful quality products. And we need to be able to tell the world that this is happening right here. When I took those same companies to Brazil, Brazil went crazy. I took them to New York, we took them to Marchena, we took them to England, and we took them to Italy. They sold out. We don't know about them. And we don't buy those products. Stick with us. In our council, we're going to start to get the word out. We're going to start putting people in buildings. We're going to work towards this.
So everybody knows, on back street, Bakery Square, there's a new bakery. They're using Bakery Square. They've revitalized it.
My brother's workshop.
That's something that people should be talking about and going to. Because there's, and the tea towers on Garden Street.
The tea house was, and I am ever so proud of them as well. As well. My brother's workshop and their work, awesome. The tea house, fantastic. She has decided that she's going to step forward. And this is her small card. This is what I am going to do. As she moved forward with the planning for Garden Street, she was very involved in that. The types of activities really called for this, and she knew that she wanted to do this all along. You should visit the tea house. It is a place where you feel like you stepped into the Virgin Islands that you knew. And I don't know how else to say that. Everyone, each one of us has an idea of the Virgin Islands that we knew, or the Virgin Islands that we want. And stepping into the tea house is as if you have reached Nirvana. Okay, so, my pet peeve.
Now we talked about Savan and so forth, and you look right behind you. You have Savan, but that's not what it looks like today. If you have these IDC companies coming here, let's call a company A. Okay, company A, that's fine. You get all these benefits. You have to restore house building number so and so in Savannah or someplace else. How would that work?
Okay, so putting on another hat, I used to head the EDC program at one time. So I know the program very well. This happens to be Store Strada. It's Savan. Store Strada into Gambler Yada.
Yeah.
Right? It is Savan. It's the entrance into Savan coming from the Market Square.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
Okay.
It
could
look like that, but I mean it is.
And this is the Valiva property on this side. Right here. Okay. So the way the law is written under Title 29 of the Virgin Islands Code, Chapter 12, it indicates that a company can receive benefits, tax exemptions under now called the EDC program, the Economic Development Program. And under that program, they are required by law to do certain things. One, to offer gainful employment for a minimal amount of people. Gainful means that they're not only employing them, and it has to be a reasonable amount of people. A hotel cannot hire 10, they must hire the amount that will make sense for the hotel. They must hire them, must give them decent wages, they must provide them health insurance and retirement, and they must also provide training, management training. Right? There must be a certain percentages of Virgin Islands residents employed, not only in the general populace, but in the specific management level. Okay? They must also invest a certain amount of money in their business. This does not mean it sits in the bank. This means that they must spend the money within the territory and must must use companies within the territory to do services that they need. It also says that they must make a donation to the Board of Education for scholarships. There's nowhere in Title 29, Chapter 12, Section 701, etc., that says that they have to make any more donations.
But there's no store house in Savannah. None of this you told about.
I'm just saying that the law does not require them to give to the Boys and Girls Club, to Queen Louise, to the restoration, like Mr. Treehouse. He decided, because the board decides, that they want to see your contribution to the community. That's nowhere in law. That is just an expectation of the board. But the law also says, in Section 708, that you can't change what they have presented to you. This is the package. It's either a yes or a no in their first four round. When they bring that package to you, it's either up or down.
So it sounds like it needs a revision to the law.
That is the law at this time.
Okay.
This one says she's revising law. So know what we're working with when they talk about the EDC. We're working with a law that gives a certain parameter and limitation. The law also does say, though, and recently amended, that they, if there is a challenge where they may have a compliance issue, they can donate money to the spray and paint or border programs of the enterprise. And we've gotten our first donation. But it's not, you know, it's an education process, but it's not a requirement. If they stay in compliance, they don't have to make a donation in any which case.
Was it Roosevelt Park that Dry House restored? Or was it something?
Treehouse, Mr. Treehouse made the determination to do two things. He did the restoration of Roosevelt Park,
yeah,
and he also sponsored the charrette for the blueprint that we have.
Right.
Okay? An EDC company that made the decision to do that. But each EDC company has their special interests. And so we'll make donations to various different things. And it's not that they're not worthy causes, because they are. When you talk to the kids at the Queen Louise home, right? They need help too. Okay? So just know that, you know, it's not that the EDC companies are not doing, they're doing. They're just not doing in this era, because there's so many needs of the community. But we have had our first donation, and they're helping us to paint the building in Salon red. Because we ran out of money to do that, and they are making, they've made the donation, and they will, that money will be able to spread a little further, because we're very good at spending money and stretching that money. And so there's a building that's historically red in Salon, and it's now being painted red. So, and fixed, of course. There was somebody lives in that, an elderly couple lives in that building, but the roof is leaking. So we're fixing it. Mm-hmm. They can't afford to fix this building.
Okay, two thoughts. The families, the multiple people that own these houses, is there a deed for these houses and this property? Does anybody pay property taxes?
Yes, yes. In the worst shaped houses, people are paying property taxes. At least one person is paying the property taxes. The deed says this person's name. That person may be three or four generations up. So the deed is still in their name, or if they've gotten that far, it's in the estate of that person.
Okay, so it's not.
Yeah.
It's, going back to Savannah, we sometimes help guests from Denmark groups walk into it,
mm-hmm,
and they desperately want to get into Savannah because, mm-hmm, one way or the other, I explained to them that that area was, the building there, there's the standing, were built by free slaves, and it was a beautiful area. And they want to go in there, but they don't do that. Well, sometimes I take the chance and I walk them in there. And they are in awe to see these narrow roads and see these houses. And whenever I walk there, I picture these houses all restored. The tourists would go wild if they could walk in there and see that. It would be the most beautiful spot. It would be, well, the French Quarter in New Orleans, I don't know how it looks now.
I think it will rival the French Quarter, because Sauvage is not only built by the free colored people of St. Thomas, but it was also built by the Huguenots, by the first Jews.
That's right.
By anyone that was tolerated by the Danish government and the Muslims. So the first Catholic hospital was in Savan. I'm with you, because I can walk and tell you the history of each building and tell you who lived in those buildings and tell you how the generations come. And I can look and imagine that as well. And so as we step forward to do this, we step forward desperate to do this, because in truth, my budget this year for my office, excluding salaries, $54,000. But we're gonna get it done, because we're gonna step forward and apply for grants. If I have to beg, I will beg. And whatever it takes, we will get it done. We're also, and you should know, that as we do buildings with owners, even though they can't afford it, can gather up, they put towards the repair of those buildings. So don't think that government is just doing it on their own. These individuals, even if they don't own all the house, even if they own 1/10 of the house, they're still putting in money towards trying to repair these buildings.
We've been given, has given $1 million, or collected $1 million.
$1.24 million.
However, 80% of it, they feel, needs to be spent on St. Croix, and the remaining 20% on St. Thomas. Mm-hmm. We have not found where this money is.
Yeah.
And it can be possible out in loans to people to fix these homes up. And commission, we decided, well, maybe it should be going to one person to fix one home up, and then when they pay back, that money is going to the next person. But that might take their whole lifetime to happen.
Actually, no, it can work.
But we have the kind of money where to put it.
I so have to say the historic preservation.
So they're not sitting in the bank. They're sort of.
Historic preservation, and I worked along with them. We try the enterprise and commercial zone commission. Steps forward all the time to collaborate with different organizations. We have jointly written letters. It's their money, so they've written 6 letters on their own as a committee, as a commission.
With a committee for St. Thomas and a commission
for both islands, right? Have written at least 6 letters. I have joined them and written 2 more with them, requesting these funds. We've created a program. We have the ability to offer through the EDA, offer loans and manage loan packages. We have our own.
But the transfer from the commission, was it done by a check or by?
It is done through the Department of Finance.
And
we write the letters.
Sometimes it's this general fund, too. No doubt, and the money's pulled elsewhere instead of where they're.
Yeah, this is the common. You know that's the practice, right?
Well, we know that, but it has to be curtailed.
One can use like Waterville and St. Croix, and I think a huge asset that we'll have is there's an artist on St. Croix, Luan Bell, who is making a documentary about her restoration of a cottage in Watergut, in Freegut. And the importance of, you know, her delving into the genealogy of who owned the house, you know, going back to the 1700s, and why it's important to the community, and how more people can get involved in renovating vernacular cottages in our towns. And I think in terms of bringing that documentary to places in schools, to organizations like the Historic Trust to screen it, I think that would be, it's a huge asset that she's bringing for us. I think we're getting the first glimpse of it coming up in July.
July 3rd,
yep.
The house that Freedom built.
Yes, one, and I'm looking forward to it. I think it's going to be a huge asset.
It is awesome. others, but she has laid, she laid the fieldwork by herself. She has learned how to do shutters and so forth. She's very dedicated. A house that Freedom built, July 3rd.
Now, Edie Woods, I worked on her committee through the Historical Trust. She used to do inventory in Savannah.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it was Sunday, two or three Sunday every month. And we would walk in there, and there was supposed to be parcel number so-and-so. We looked at something had been there, but it was gone. Now, she had all these files. Have you ever seen these files, or this? Have you seen them? Okay.
Yes, I'm a collector of Virgin Islands history books, but I'm also an avid fan of Mr. Lockhart and his postcards, and also all the files and so forth. My father-in-law, Colito Ken, went back in and did photographs at the time that, as an artist that he is, at the time that he was working with art students that are now artists themselves, to include Rachel Turnbull, Peter Gonzalez, Myron Jackson, Evas, Linda Carwood, and all of those. They took photos of almost every building for historic preservation of those buildings. So I've seen old photos, I've seen postcards, I've seen newer photos, when I say newer, 1970s, 1980s photos, and then we have, and we are taking photos, in fact this week we start to take photos again. So we understand the inventory that's there. We continue to move forward with it. It's a labor of love.
You were talking about the buildings now, strictly from the outside. And I could tell you a lot about the buildings inside. I used to do store interiors in St. John's here when we closed the business a couple of years ago. I wanted to preserve the old walls, the old ceilings. And if you go into a store on Main Street where the apothecary hall used to be, and you remove the ceilings I have installed, you would find the old ceilings on top. None of the store owners wanted to keep the old walls, the old beams, nothing. Just covered up with paneling or painted. What could I do?
No, but it's still there.
It's still there someplace behind the 10 sheets of plywood or paneling or what have you. And that's sad. They said, oh, you can do anything inside. Don't worry about the outside, you can't change.
It, you know, it is a matter of understanding, and as a couple of you said, education.
Mm-hmm.
Really is. Okay. I want to close my talk in a few minutes, so I want to tell you what my pet peeve is. And thankfully, I don't think any of you made those statements today. But if you did, please excuse me. It's a pet peeve of mine. It frustrates me. That passive statement, or that anonymous read. We should do this and not the other. We should do this. Don't you hate if you're planning and you're in charge of planning something and you said, okay, we need to have food, we need to have chairs, we need to have a place, we need to have the recorder, we need to have a projector. Yes, we should do that. That does not get it done. We should do this. Or the passive statement, it would be good if that is done. Haven't we all heard those words?
I said
it. It would be good. And we should do this, yes. I want us to eliminate those phrases from our vocabulary. They have gotten us to where we are today. And we need to do better. And that wasn't the we, the anonymous we. The we, me included, need to do So you remember those cards that you filled out, the smaller cards that you are thinking that you want to do something? There are more of those little things that we can do. The challenge. Our saying in Enterprise Zone is performance-based, results-driven. And we hold each of our team members to that. So at the beginning of the year, there's four of us total. At the beginning of the year, four of us territory-wide. At the beginning of the year, fiscal year, we sit down and say, okay, here's our strategic plan. What can we do? Which ideas are we going to lead? All four of us, no administrative assistants. How are we going to do this? Who is going to do what? So, team number one, two, three, four, each take projects. So, okay, I'm going to lead that project. This is the time period. This is the assistance I will need, the resources, the human resources, the financial resources we're going to need to get that project done. So, performance-based, results-driven. These are the results we're going to get. This is the benchmark we want to hit. Okay, that's how we function in my office. So, I started off my speech today talking about acknowledging who we are and making efforts to look at something from someone else's perspective. So, I told you who I am, right? And I sort of led you into thinking or looking at it from my eyes. I want you to think about it as we form our council. Right? They may think that historic preservation is a shibbo. Bad people. Or they're going to kick up the dust and do something bad. But let's look at it through their eyes and see their challenges that they face, and maybe we can come up with better solutions. Right? Keep the big ideas simple. We're going to form the council, right? And we're going to come to the table with one. I think the big idea was bringing activity to downtown areas and residential to downtown areas, and creating residential in town, not only here in St. Thomas, but in Kishisa and Frederick said their ideas are the same. How they go about doing that, they're different. But it's one basic idea that will work. And then I want to throw out to you a 26-week challenge. If you are on Facebook, you know that there's all kinds of challenges, right? We have 27 weeks left this year. Did you know that? The 26-week challenge is that I want you to think about that small card and do something throughout that 26 weeks. Do something. I'll give you an empty card for you to write something else for yourself. But I want you to do something. Take action. Don't sit there and say, yeah, that was okay. You know? And not think about what we, as individuals, one, fills the basket. Right? No matter how big the challenge or the issue or that basket is, if you keep putting one idea and doing one thing, that leads to a larger positive something. It will fill that basket. It may be, since your expertise, gentlemen in the back, expertise is construction and looking at the inside of buildings, maybe you want to talk to the young apprentice, the young men who would like to be able to do something like that but don't know how. I already told you that I'm going to be doing the genealogies, because we have some of those big challenges, we're going to deal with those big challenges. one generation at a time. Each one of you have expertise in different areas.
There's one good thing.
I want you to separate yourself and your mind from your organization at this moment and think about you as an individual. What one little thing? It may be that you're apprehensive about going into Saban.
I will take you into Saban
if you're apprehensive. I will take you into Frederickstead, Christiansted, upstreet, downstreet. I will take you in. It's not a problem to me. You may not know me, but it's okay. It's fine. You're Virgin Islanders, we say good afternoon when we walk. And we keep going. And they will join us to help us. Right? So, do that one thing. Take that 26-week challenge. Do something. Take action. You don't have to ever remember my name or whatever I said today, but I want you to remember that one thing. And it's within all of us to do that. Remember I told you about my four team members? We have worked towards fixing buildings throughout our communities. We do other programs too. We have an estate planning conference where we tell people about helping people to do their wills and trusts and all kinds of things. We work with small manufacturers to help them go around the world, help them with their marketing, help them to grow. We have stakeholder conferences where we work with our stakeholders, our 501c3s, the Out of Town Frederickstead, the FEDAS, the WeFUS, the WeFUS of Street Group, and we help them to grow as organizations so that they can help their individuals. These are all befores and afters of those buildings. It's not impossible. It is not impossible.
What is this to do?
So these are from St. Louis, St. Croix, St. Thomas, and
they're from Wolfish Islands. We still have lots to do. These are buildings that are pet peeves for us, that we promise ourselves we're going to do. Church Street, Frederickstead. Christiansted. King Street, Frederickstead. I used to go and have hamburgers and cheeseburgers and a cherry coke. St. Thomas, Noriega. This is upstreet. I used to sit right here. Right there, didn't have a fence, they didn't have a gate on the top. To sit right there and watch the parades pass by. That's when the parades used to go all the way to the head of Page Street and go up to the thing. Now they turn at the park. But before, they used to go to the head of Page Street and come up to the stadium. And I used to sit there and be able to catch the push-up ice cones that they used to draw from Clips of Ice Cream. Downstream, perhaps our biggest challenge, it is a long road.
Oh, yeah.
A long road that my team and I, every day as we pass by, struggle with how we're going to find the funds to fix it. We're going to fix it. We just need to find those funds. We're not talking about millions of dollars. We had about $100,000 we were ready to go. Because we're going to come to historic preservation, and we're not going to have a challenge. We're not going to have a challenge because we understand the rules, and we play by the rules.
But now you see with the government, like if you're driving up a building road, and you're following the narrow road there, where you have the Boy Scout being down to the left, that wall on the left side is a typical old Danish wall. They were either like this or curved, which you can see at the Danish cemetery. Part of that wall was knocked down and damaged. Now somebody has repaired it, just slapping something in flat. That should be stopped within the government.
What we need is education.
Well, no, not really. You need, they need to be stopped and fined. Because the only thing that stops people is they get fined and they gotta pay money out. That will stop it.
We need education because not all of us, know that that should have been.
Well,
that
you pass that every day, I'm sure.
Actually, not really. But I know the wall that you're talking about. But there needs to be an education process. They're just out there trying to fix the wall because
yeah, that's going to fix the wall.
I want to say thank you for listening to me today. Here are some transformations that we made in each of our districts. Actually, two buildings are actually in Savannah, one in Christians and one in Fredericksburg. But there are lots of that, and I want everybody to be involved in some way or the other in being able to successfully do something like that. It may just be the education. It may be buying some paint, being out there educating young people, talking about history, talking about doing things and actually doing them. So thank you so much.
Thank you. It's just when you're talking about maybe having a group, because like I remember at the end of the school year, there was an all-state student that did a presentation on the restoration of downtown, and me, not the historic preservation or historical trust, knew about this. And she would have been wonderful to have a student on board while she was doing that, but she went about it herself. And we need more like that. It's hard. Like we have a core group that we can attract and to educate and be great.
We do have on the 9th, it's another project that we decided to take on, but on the 9th, we're going to try to do a historic walk through Savan. Mm-hmm. And I've decided it's going to be led or started by a student who worked for Enterprise World during the summer, a couple summers ago. They did research and were able to find things out that, you know, you're like, wow, the first governor, the first native governor of this territory was born in Savan. You want to know why there's so many doctors and lawyers, judges, musicians, athletes coming out of Savan. They went and they called them. They called Judge Swan, they called Governor Snyder. Said, tell us, how was it to live in Savan? And they told them, especially they had a good long discussion with Governor Snyder, and he told them why he thought there were so many successful people. Every governor from St. Thomas has been, or their family has been, out of Savan. It's a place to know, to understand.
So that's are we going to hear about that day, what time and so forth?
July 9th, I'm working towards like 9:30, 10 o'clock. As soon as I finish this and my speech next Saturday, I will announce that.
Okay.
And where am I going to be?
In Savan.
That one.
The speech next week is at the Caribbean Genealogy Library. I am covering the topic facing slavery and how to do research during that time period.
That's
really
cool.
Different topic for this week. Mm-hmm. Any other questions?
Well, we probably have a lot, but yesterday talking about. But yeah, I want to say one thing. You're also dealing with people's egos in many aspects. Especially when the word garbage, which is on everybody's mind, because there have been some changes in collecting garbage on the island. When I walk, either with my dog or myself, I bring a plastic bag and I pick up. From our area, I change the route I'm going, and I can walk down the road where there are educated people who you said should know better. They can have right in front of their gate, electric gate, there can be bottles and garbage, and they probably go in out several times. I pick it up. They don't. Why?
Is it
wrong?
No, but I mean, it is mind-boggling because I think in many of these cases here, you are dealing with that personality.
Agreed, and I think that maybe we should start taking pictures of this activity. And so I'm posting it.
Yeah, I remember you on your radio. Were you the one that wanted the camera up at the garden?
I heard that was somebody who I was on a radio show last week,
yeah.
Or earlier this week.
Yeah, listening to it.
And
yeah.
Somebody called in. We're talking about collaboration and communication, and she said we should add cameras.
Well, it's like Big Brother awards. I'm just saying,
take the picture. Maybe you might want to give them the picture and not just say, take the picture and
put it on the gate.
See, sometimes you know we walk down the street, we see Main Street the way we want to see Main Street. You know, people will not see the deterioration, the decay, the fading paint. They won't see it because they're passing by that building all the time. So you have to sort of show it to them in a different way. Take a picture of the garbage and give it to them so that they can see. You take out the garbage after you take a picture, but so that they can see. Mm-hmm. Any other thoughts? I'm leaving you with take
action.
Thank you. Take action.
I want to thank Nadine for being with us. I want to say Ronnie was right when he said that you're very thorough and you go step by step and we know exactly what your message is. What I also saw and heard was a very big heart behind all of this, didn't you? I mean,
yes.
I feel moved and motivated. I feel inspired. I feel so grateful to you for being here. This is just a little gift.
Thank you.
From all of us.
Thank you.
Yes. You're wonderful. Thanks.
Thank you so much for inviting me. I sat in that chair the last time.
Yes, you did.
And I was just filled with so much that I was honored to get the call to add to the conversation.
Good.
So thank you again.
You're welcome. I will say to all of you, thank you for coming. This sort of concludes our series for the summer. And we'll pick back up again in October, November. We'll see what will happen, what we want to do, what kind of feedback we get. But you all are wonderful to come and support this. We thank you. And if there's anything the Trust can do as an organization or to promote our members committing to one thing for 26 weeks, maybe we can do that. There's no reason why we can't. So, yes, you've inspired us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, thank you, thank you all. Have a great summer. Stay cool.
Yeah.
That's hard.